Hello friends, this is Dr. Hinge from TSSM's BSCOER. From the topic of Diversion Headworks, today we will discuss about design of weir on permeable foundation by using Khosla's theory. This is a typical layout of Diversion Headwork showing its component parts. As a prerequisite, we must know that in case of weir, major ponding of water is due to weir crest, whereas in case of barrage, it is due to the gate. These are the causes of failure of weir on permeable foundation. The piping occurs due to the water that oozes out at downstream with some seepage pressure or some residual seepage pressure. If this seepage pressure is dissipated by proportioning the length of floor B and the depth of sheet pile D, then the danger of piping can be avoided. The sheet pile is also referred to as cutoff. This is a typical concrete weir with downstream glacis. It is known that by increasing the creep length, more seepage head can be dissipated. Creep length can be increased by increasing the floor length, but it is uneconomical. Creep length can also be increased by providing cutoff or sheet pile. Now let us discuss about Blighs creep theory. Blighs was the first to propose creep theory with the help of arrows. He had shown the path of creep or the path of seepage flow below floor. With dotted line, he has demonstrated as to how the uplift pressure dissipates in the flow direction. Blighs has assumed that the loss of head is proportional to creep length L only. He has also given condition for safety against piping. He has also recommended values of safe hydraulic gradients for different types of soils. He has also given the equation to calculate the thickness of floor T. This is how the floor thickness is derived with safety factor 4/3. Now let's move on to Khosla's theory of independent variables. With this prerequisite knowledge, now we will discuss about Khosla's theory. There were many cases of failure in past where the weirs designed with Blighs creep theory or lens weighted creep theory have failed. This has motivated Khosla to propose another theory. Now, these are the additional features of Khosla's theory. Number one, Khosla has considered the thickness of floor, the mutual interference of piles, and the slope of floor, and accordingly, he has suggested the corrections. Now, these features were not considered by previous researchers. Number two, instead of dealing with the floor system as a whole, he has broken it into small or individual or independent cases and analyzed them separately. Hence, it is known as theory of independent variables. Number three, Khosla and his associates developed the curves to calculate percentage uplift pressures at the key points like E, D and C, which are the junction points of pile and floor, the bottom point of piles, and also the bottom corners of depressed floor. Number four, a deep cutoff at downstream end is also a valuable contribution of Khosla's theory. And number five, the exit gradient has been given enough weightage in Khosla's theory. These are the standard forms considered in Khosla's theory. Here, the floor length is denoted by B and the pile depth is denoted by letter D. Figure A shows the pile at upstream end. Figure B shows pile at downstream end. In slide 18, the upper chart is used for upstream and downstream sheet pile analysis. Now, figure C shows an intermediate pile. In slide 18, you will be able to find the separate chart for analysis of intermediate pile. Figure D shows depressed floor. Now let us see the corrections for thickness of floor. These corrections are required to be applied as Khosla's curves give the values of phi, that is percentage uplift pressures at the top of floor, but we require it at the bottom of floor. That is, in figure A, phi c can be read from curve, but phi c1 can be obtained after applying appropriate correction to phi c. Now let us understand in detail how the correction is calculated. As the path of creep is from E to D, D to C1, and C1 to C, it means the uplift pressure will go on decreasing along this path. Therefore, pressure at C1 must be greater than the pressure at C. Thus, the correction is positive. So far, its magnitude is concerned, it is calculated by using rule of 3, that is, the pressure difference over whole depth of pile D1 is phi D minus phi C. Thus, pressure difference over part depth T1, that is floor thickness, will be given as phi D minus phi C upon D1 multiplied by T1. And this value is added to phi C. This is how corrected value of pressure at C1 is calculated. Similarly, in figure B, correction for phi E is calculated and it's subtractive because along creep length, point E is encountered first and point E1 is encountered next. And as pressure decreases along creep direction, pressure at E1 is obviously less than pressure at E. Now in figure C, correction for downstream pile is shown. As a thumb rule, you may remember that correction for C1 is always positive and correction at E1 is always negative or subtractive. For correction for mutual interference, the depth of pile should be measured from the floor bottom. This is because the interference phenomenon occurs below floor, but for all other corrections, depth of pile should be measured from top of floor. Also note that with reference to the flow direction, the correction is additive for rear points and it is subtractive for forward points. This is because the forward sheet pile tend to increase the pressure at rear sheet pile and the rear sheet pile tend to reduce the pressure at forward sheet pile. It is as if we are putting some obstruction in the direction of flow that tend to increase the head on upstream. The correction for slope should be referred from the table. It is additive for a downward slope and subtractive for the upward slope. This is because pressure increases from top to bottom and pressure decreases from bottom to top. Now let us understand the Khosla's curves in detail. For upstream sheet pile and downstream sheet pile, refer upper chart, that is chart in right corner, upper right corner. Let us see the upstream sheet pile in detail. Now here phi c1 is equal to 100 minus phi e. The value of phi e can be obtained from phi e curve. It is to be read on y-axis on right hand side from the point of intersection of 1 upon alpha, which is equal to d upon b, and on x-axis with phi e curve, where d is depth of pile and b is total floor length. Similarly, phi d1 is equal to 100 minus phi d can be calculated. Let us see the downstream sheet pile. Here, you will directly get the values of phi e and phi d from the intersection of 1 upon alpha with corresponding curve. Here you have to refer y-axis on right hand side and x-axis on top. Now let us see the intermediate sheet pile. For this, you have to refer the lower chart showing two different sets of curves for phi c and phi d respectively, each ranging from alpha is equal to 0 to alpha is equal to 30. Here, x-axis represents values of b1 upon b, where b1 is the distance of intermediate sheet pile from upstream end, and b is the total length of floor. Therefore, the value of phi c can be read on y-axis on left-hand side corresponding to the point of intersection of ratio b1 upon b on x-axis and corresponding curve of alpha is equal to b upon d. Similarly, phi d can be read on y-axis on right-hand side corresponding to ratio b1 upon b on x-axis and corresponding phi d curve. Now, phi e is equal to 100 minus phi c for alpha is equal to alpha and 1 minus b1 upon b. This is how you can calculate the exit gradient, and these are the values of maximum permissible exit gradients for different types of soils. This is the photograph of Asia's biggest lift irrigation scheme, which is situated at Tembu Karad in Maharashtra, India. Thank you.